Okay. Good morning and welcome to STL History Live, Mexican Migration and the Railroads. My name is Aaron Pelker. I'm a community engagement coordinator with the Missouri History Museum's Public History Department, and I want to thank you for spending part of your Tuesday morning with us. Before we get to our presentation, I do have a couple of brief remarks. I want to mention that both the Missouri History Museum in Forest Park and the Soldiers Memorial Military Museum in downtown St. Louis are both open to the public from Wednesday through Sunday. Your safety is a top priority, and we would love for you to visit if you feel comfortable doing so. Advanced free reservations are required to visit both locations, but please feel free to visit mohistory.org to plan your visit and reserve your free tickets. And I also want to mention that our library and research center is now reopened for in-person appointments by reservations on Thursdays and Fridays. Again, I encourage you to check our website, mohistory, that's mohistory.org, for further details. Also, I want to thank our museum members and the Zoo Museum Tax District for their generous support for both our exhibits and our programming. We wouldn't be able to host programs like this morning without their contributions. Also, I do want to mention that this morning's program is also presented in conjunction with a statewide effort to honor Missouri's bicentennial this year. I'll drop a link in the chat to the statewide event calendar for programs related to Missouri's bicentennial and history. And lastly, before I turn it over to our presenter for this morning's program, I do want to explain a few of the features you'll find on Zoom that may be helpful this morning. First, this will be about a 45 to 50 minute presentation with some time at the end for our presenter to answer a few questions. You can submit your questions for our speaker at any time through the Q&A feature on your Zoom toolbar. We're also happy to offer closed captioning through Zoom. To enable closed captioning, simply click the CC button on your Zoom toolbar. And finally, at the conclusion of the program, we hope you'll complete a short survey that will open automatically in your internet browser. We appreciate and look forward to your feedback. With that, I'd like to introduce our speaker this morning, Sal Valadez, Diversity Outreach and Marketing Representative for LiUNA Midwest Region. So thanks and enjoy the presentation. And Sal, take it away.
Oh, good morning, everyone. Just waiting for the slides to show up. Okay, good morning, everyone. And thank you very much for joining us today. A few people I'd like to thank, the Museum, Missouri History Museum, for their invitation to present. Their staff, Aaron and Lindsay Newton, who organizes and manages the Latinx project, Gilberto Pinella, who is the chair of the Latinx advisory committee, for his support. And also to all the researchers out there that have focused on this topic in many ways, and for their research. And hopefully my goal is to contribute something to the information and inspire people to ask more questions, to tell stories. You know, the stories about our history is so important. And in Missouri, the Latinx community is the largest ethnic community in the state. We have a long history. Kansas City and St. Louis have the largest communities, but we're all over the state. So this is a tribute to the early immigrants from Mexico and their descendants and their stories. So next. History always begins with questions. And this presentation is an overview of the story of the journey that immigrants, the people from Mexico that took the railroads, it took the perilous journey to develop our railroads here in Missouri and the rest of the United States. If you look back at the research that's done, if there was a railroad, there were probably Mexicans working and living close by. from Rhode Island to California, from Minnesota to Texas. And so we're going to ask some key questions that you see here, but there are facts that you need to know in advance. There were two major periods of migrations from Mexico that were facilitated by the U.S. and Mexican railroads from 1900 to 1920. With the railroad development and in the United States in World War I. From 1942 to 1964, there was a bracero program, guest workers. There were also two very large Mexican forced repatriations. We'll talk about those a little bit later. One during the Depression, the 1930s under President Hoover, and Operation Wetback in 1954 under President Eisenhower. Now, a note, in doing the research, it was a bit hampered. I couldn't really go to the archives and to the libraries because of the COVID-19 crisis. So I was limited to using El Google. And I've managed to find quite a bit of information. And so I really appreciate the technology that is available to us to do this kind of research. Next. So traqueros is our main topic. Traqueros were railroad workers in the United States and primarily from 1870 to 1830 as covered by the late Dr. Jeffrey Marcos Garcilaso's book, Traqueros, Mexican Railroad Workers in the United States. And he really put together a great book. And I encourage people who are interested in this subject to read the book, to buy a book, read the book. And he mentioned chain migration, which refers to the process of immigrants from a particular region following the path of the families and the people before them to the United States. And they were incentivized to bring along their families, including wives and children, to live on sites by the railroad yards rent-free. A key tactic of the strategy was the practice of housing traqueros and converted boxcars. And we'll be talking about that. Basically, there were two kinds of communities. One was a mobile village that moved along the train tracks, and other types were boxcars that were taken off their wheels and grouping them together in the outskirts of rail yards. And these were usually saved for section gangs, people that worked on the railroad. Next. Here's an example. On your left is a railroad boxcar village on the Chicago, Burlington, and Quincy right-of-way in West Eola, Aurora, Illinois, in around the 1920s. And the right is a wooden dormitory that was used by section crews, an example of a car that was used, a boxcar that was used to house crews as they worked along the tracks. Next. So what it was the role of Mexico, St. Louis, and the development of U.S. and Mexican railroads? Let's explore that for a little bit. Next. Daniel Gonzalez, my friend and colleague and former historian at St. Louis County, who is now at the Illinois Historical Society, wrote a series of the early Mexicans in St. Louis. And he shows that relationship started with trade along the Santa Fe Trail that began in near Kansas City. And his information, the research that he's done, and he's done a series of research projects are terrific. And you've got the links. It would be worthwhile to take a look at his work. In this particular slide, the Gateway to the East, an explanation of St. Louis's Mexican history through the built environment. He features the Mexican and Spanish American commercial exchange from the 1880s. So we know that commerce was growing and developing between Mexico and St. Louis very early on. Next. So St. Louis, Henry Clay Pierce, Mexican President Porfirio Diaz, John F. Cahill, Mexican consul and publisher of El Comercio del Valle. Porfirio Diaz, the president of the Republic of Mexico, was very interested in trade and commerce between Mexico and St. Louis. And almost immediately, when he was elected, he appointed Cahill as Mexican consul in St. Louis. And providing the links between trade between Missouri and Mexico. And the MKT eventually linked directly to the line of the Mexican National Railway to facilitate this trade. Trade was very much important, and there were commercial interests in St. Louis. Capitalists bought mines, railroads, factories, and farms all over Mexico. And another major player was the St. Louis oilman Henry Clay Pierce. And you can see from the list of properties on this slide that he had quite large interest in petroleum, other commerce in the breadth and width of Mexico. When Porfirio Diaz was finally overthrown through the Mexican Revolution, it was quoted that this was a simple proxy struggle between St. Louis capitalists and interests based in Great Britain, a fight which we have on one side, the interested of the old departments of Wheatman Pearson of Great Britain, and on the other side, the Walters Pierce Oil Company of St. Louis, which has been promised to by Mexico to St. Louis in the future, according to a Mexican newspaper. Next. So the United States Railroad's role in the development of Mexican railroads, it began in the 1880s very aggressively. And you can see the list of companies that were building to build make connections into Mexico. And you'll see that the St. Louis, Brownsville, Mexican Railroad reached Matamoros in 1883. It became a major link back to St. Louis. Next. Here's another interesting note from an article published by the New York Times in 1907 to show the extent of the interest of the railroads in the railroads of Mexico. S.M. Felton, president of the Chicago and Alton, which reached into St. Louis, was elected the president of the Mexican Central Railway Company that year. And it is the general belief of the directors meeting of the Alton, at which his resignation will be accepted, that Theodore P. Schatz, president of Toledo, St. Louis, and Western Railroad, will be elected in Mr. Felton's place. Now, the important thing about this is you see as we go through the program, the Mexican Central Railway Company played a huge role in the development of the railroads in Mexico. linking us to the United States, to Missouri and other railroads. And this again was a company that was controlled by railroad companies here in St. Louis. So next. The early 20th century migration was marked by U.S. and Mexican historical events that included domestic turmoil, poverty, and war. Next. The Chinese Exclusionary Act of 1882 was a main cause for the demand for Mexican labor in the U.S. There had been a historical the only way to explain it is historical discrimination towards Asians. And the Chinese, although they played an important role in the development of the intercontinental railroad here in the United States, were nonetheless excluded beginning in 1882 and were basically kicked out of the country. Many of them fled to Mexico and other countries. Simply because they were Chinese. And what happened is that it created a vacuum for cheap labor, and it contributed to Mexicans coming up north. Next. The other contributing factors on the Mexican side were the Mexican Revolution of 1910 to 1920, the end of Porfirio Diaz's president/dictator, who was in the seat of power from 1876 to 1911. On the left-hand side, you see the kind of terror that the people of Mexico, the unlanded, the peons of Mexico, suffered under Porfirio Diaz. These are his rurales, Mexican police who took care of the countryside by, in this case, enforcing Porfirio Diaz's laws. And this scene of people being shot. And on the right, the development of the railroads also played a key role in the Mexican Revolution, because both sides, the federal side and the revolutionaries that were led by Zapata and Pancho Villa, used the railroads as weapons and as troop carriers. Next. The next event was Mexico's Cristero War, 1926 to 29. And that actually started as the federal government of Mexico, when the revolution ended, the people in power more or less wanted to keep the church, the Catholic Church, under control. And the President Calles was very brutal about it. The persecution actually began immediately as soon as the Mexican Revolution was over, and President Calles took it to an extreme, took extreme measures. And on the left hand, these are people hanging from telephone poles along the railroad tracks in Jalisco. And there was such an international uproar that President Calles ordered his soldiers to do the hanging beyond the telephone poles. The U.S. was very concerned with the unrest, their oil interests, their commercial interests, and other interests were in peril. And so President Coolidge sent Ambassador Murrow, who is a figure in St. Louis history also, along with, in this case, in this picture, Charles Lindbergh and humorist Will Rogers in 1927. And in 1929, there was an agreement that was reached between the president, but Calles was still in power, and behind the scenes, and the Archbishop of Mexico, Leopoldo Ruiz y Flores, which brought that conflict to an end. Next. Another phenomenon that happened early in the 20th century was the 1924, between 1924 and 1954, the border crossings became a crime in the United States, whereas before people were going back and forth. In terms of my family and other families that I've known, they were crossing what some would consider illegally across the border to work. So this was an event that changed how the border was used. And in 1924, the Border Patrol was created, and with it, enforcement of the regulations along the border became much stricter. During the Depression in the United States, there was an increased negativity and hostility towards immigrants, and the federal government passed laws imposing restrictions and penalties for hiring immigrants. In the 1930s, over 1 million people were repatriated to Mexico during this period, but it's some estimates claim it to be 2 million. And of these repatriated Mexicans, 60% were citizens of the United States of Mexican origin, and with very tragic consequences. In 1942, the US and Mexico signed the Mexican Farm Labor Agreement, better known as the Bracero Program. This was during World War II, and there was a shortage of labor, and many people came to work in different industries, including the railroad. In 1954, the Mexican immigrants and nationals were caught up in an operation consisting of Border Patrol agents that located and processed and deported Mexicans who had entered the U.S. allegedly illegally. Approximately 1,074,277 people were returned to Mexico, 500,000 of them from Texas alone. Next. Believe that was okay. Thank you. So we already covered the forced reparations. We can go on to the next slide. How we got here, the roads we took to America. Next. So the railroads were the major way that the Mexicans traveled to the United States. And when I say we, I am an immigrant. I was born in Mexico, and I traveled up here, and I came up as a 3 or 4 year old in the 1955, I believe. So when I say we, it's very personal to me. So these railroads facilitated the opening up and delivery to important American markets in the north, which included transporting immigrants to those various destinations. Next. The one crucial ingredient linking all of these immigrants from every corner of Mexico was their use of the Mexican railway systems. And the original purpose behind creating these systems did not anticipate the level of immigration that would take place between 1900 and 2000. Next. The U.S. railroads that carried passengers and cargo to and from Mexico. These are some selected maps. Next. So the Atchison, Topeka, Santa Fe Railroad, built railroads that by 1892 reached all the way, as you follow the red line, to the west coast of the mainland, Mexico. And there were a lot of mining interests in this, and of course was used as a transportation hub for bringing people to and from the United States. And you can see that it linked through Kansas and Missouri. So next. The Burlington Route. My family was deeply involved with the Burlington Route on both sides of my family, with the railroads in general. And as you can see, the Burlington Route extended from Chicago all the way down south to central Mexico. And this was in 1892. Next. And the Missouri Pacific Lines, a major player. If you noticed in the opening slide of the presentation, there was a MOPAC and Mexico Railroad linkage signed from a flyer or a timetable going back and forth to Mexico. And as you can see, it runs through St. Louis out west, but the St. Louis lines takes you directly through Texas and into Mexico City. So this is a map of 1930. Next. And the International and Great Northern Railroad had the Mexico to St. Louis special. And this was in 1906. If you follow the blue line from St. Louis for through the South and through Texas, you'll see that it connects here at a point in Texas. I believe that was Laredo. And it goes, I'm sorry, the maps are so small, but if you get a copy of this in a PDF, which we'll be happy to supply, you'll be able to see every town along the way. And it goes directly in through central Mexico and into Mexico City. Next. So as early as 1915, the MOPAC, Missouri Pacific and the National Railways of Mexico ran connecting trains through and from St. Louis, San Antonio, Laredo, and Nuevo Laredo. This on the left is a set of Texas Eagle trains in St. Louis. And on the right, you'll see the schedule. You'll see the starting point, St. Louis, Missouri, and the ending point, Laredo, Texas, on the American side, and ending in Mexico City, Mexico. So that was a train schedule from 1948. Next. Railroads recruit Mexican workers and American perceptions of Mexico. Just spend a little time of that to talk about the people, because basically history is about people. It's their stories that are so important. And so let's see what the next slide. So what happened here? Okay, the Chicago, Burlington, and Quincy Railroad was one of many, many, many railroads that provided ads into Mexico for workers. This type of advertisement is very, very rare. So I'm going to translate a little bit of this from the CB&Q to attention workers in Mexico. You are needed in the United States. Your family is invited also to live and work with the Burlington Railroad the track work, the section work, and live at the camps. And the first line reads, La compañía se encarga de proporcionar a los trabajadores con su mayoría comunidad. In other words, they're going to provide with everything that you need. They're going to give you a boxcar, a stove, and coal, completely free. And we do not charge for el enganche. We'll talk about that, the hook, the contract. So everybody is invited. And your work includes work in Illinois, Wisconsin, Iowa, Missouri, Nebraska, Colorado, Sur Dakota, South Dakota, Montana, Wyoming. And you can contact them at any of these offices, Kansas City and Omaha, Nebraska. Next. El enganche, the hook. So labor recruiters use the rail system to travel from the Southwest to the central states of Guanajuato, Jalisco, Michoacán, and Zacatecas. My family is from that region, from Zacatecas and Aguascalientes. It's a region called the Bajío. So they're recruited from that region, and this system became known as el enganche, the hook, because recruiters hook peasants with false expectations and promises of great rewards, when in reality, the work conditions better resembled indentured servitude. Next. This is the 1908 bulletin of the U.S. Department of Labor. And the source of immigration, as the previous slide showed, that it was chiefly between the states of Jalisco, which, according to them, are reputed to have the best laborers, Michoacán, and this is an evaluation by the Department of Labor. I want to make that very clear. So it included Jalisco, Michoacán, Guanajuato, Aguascalientes, and Zacatecas. Those are three very close states in the middle of Mexico. But there were railroad connections that brought in workers from all over Mexico into the main lines that had them travel north. Next. And the occupations where they are employed for this chapter by Victor S. Clark, PhD, working for the Bureau of Labor in a 1908 bulletin. So with the possible exception of agriculture, there are many Mexicans that are employed in the railway laborers. They are distributed in, at this point, all of Texas, New Mexico, and Arizona. They are also the main labor employed in the railroads of California and Nevada, Colorado, and Wyoming. And they are increasing as workers along the Chicago, Rock Island and Pacific Railway, and the Atchison, Topeka, and Santa Fe Railway through Kansas, Missouri, and even into Chicago. But we know from other histories, other documents, they went and worked in New York, in east, south, west, north, it didn't matter. If there were railroads, Mexicans were working on them. And these documents, it's very interesting, these federal documents, and there are several. You'll have access through them through the links that I provided. They had some very peculiar observations about the railroad workers. it is, if you follow into about the third paragraph, the reason for the growing use of Mexican labor in these occupations are that it is cheap and docile. But these qualities alone would not give it favor were it not also that they're fairly efficient. Employers and foremen do not differentiate in the various motives that induce them to prefer a certain kind of labor, but they are usually perfectly clear to the order of choice among the different nationalities. And according to a trackmaster, Mexicans are better than the Greeks or the Italians next to the American hobo. They must be well-fed and want fresh beef and mutton, but do not eat much pork. They don't have feuds, and it goes on and on. So it's a rather, it sets the kind of the pace, because there were so many workers. You can imagine when these opinions about people, whether it's the Mexicans, the Greeks, or the Italians, are in the railroad. They also, the railroads are a microcosm of the community in general. So you can imagine that these stereotypes, these ideas about who people are, spread. And so you start seeing as the years go by that these spread through the communities where the Mexicans live. And there's a form of discrimination that starts to evolve. Next. Another perspective comes from the Mexican Labor or the Railway Age Gazette. And I don't have to, I'm looking at my time, I'm not going to go through this, but it kind of follows on what was previously said in the previous slide. Just pick a line here. The Mexicans possess a number of characteristics which tend to make him a good trackman. Comparing him with other trackmen as we find them today, he often prefers section work and extra gang work because he wishes to bring his family with him, differing in this way from the Italian who seldom prefers section work. And it goes on and on and on. In hindsight, these are very destructive. Although they seem to sound good, they're destructive in a way to other communities. At the end, the author says another point brought out of the papers, which is a sad reflection on our American influence, is the fact that the first year's work of the Mexican is his best, and as he becomes Americanized, his efficiency and loyalty decrease. Next slide. In the early decades, the 20th century, St. Louis and Kansas City were primary destinations for Mexican traqueros and their families. Next. And as you can see here, is a article stored at the State Historical Society of Missouri, and explains how the Mexican communities were taken care of by the Guadalupe Centers and the International Institute. And it's a good read if you want to really understand what the conditions and the response of social welfare institutions in Kansas City were like. Next. A look back at the 20th century boom. Here, this is another article by my friend Daniel Gonzalez. And he did some wonderful work, wonderful articles. And here is a picture of a boxcar community. This is about the only picture that we've been able to find of a boxcar community in St. Louis. And, And this is the Zuniga family, and their son, Gus Zuniga, went on to go to school and eventually became an executive with the construction company. And Anna Croslin, in an interview, said, celebrating the 100th anniversary of the Institute here in St. Louis, says, well, we were founded in 1919. We went to where the need was. So the International Institute has had a long history in St. Louis of taking care of immigrants, including Mexicans in the early 20th centuries, when they were about the same time they were founded and they were starting to arrive in St. Louis. Next. Mexican in St. Louis. This is another article. This is just evidence that we were here, by Daniel Gonzalez. I encourage you to read his work. Next. The Guadalupe Center. They have a long history. I encourage you to visit their archives to get the oral histories, the other histories that they've collected. And in Kansas City, like St. Louis is a city that sits in two states, and so there were Mexicans in Kansas City, Kansas City, Kansas. Kansas City, Kansas has a large history also. And the photo here is El Campo del Mexicano in Kansas City, Kansas. So that's one of the few photos that exist of the Mexican communities in Kansas City. Next. Evidence, Taqueros in Missouri, the census data courtesy of ancestry.com. Next. So I picked up a few census, and you know, there were a lot of records, but I had to be very selective, and I focused on railroad workers and where they lived. And I found them working in all parts of Missouri and living in what we can only describe as boxcar communities. So next. You can't see all of this, but in the margins over here, it says these are all Mexicans here. If you look at their descriptions, and they're living on railroad property. Next. Same census, second page. And in the margins, it says these are railroad section gangs and Mexicans living on railroad property. Next. And again, there were actually three pages. This is a railroad, and the margin, it says it's a railroad extra gang camp. Next. And that's the last one. In Harrison County, there was quite a large group. And again, in the margin, if you can see on the left hand, if you can turn your head a little bit, it says basically that they're living in a boxcar community. So here's the evidence. Next, please. Next, please. Okay, the 1910 census, Rock Island Railroad, Bowles Township, Franklin County, Mexican workers. Next. And I apologize if I'm rushing. I'm looking at the time. We do want to have a little time to chat, ask questions. So we're gonna kind of fly through these slides, and with apologies. Again, this is an evidence. If you look, all of the people born in Mexico, you may not be able to see, but they're all born in Mexico, or the majority of those on the same first page. Next. And again, the following page, Mexico, 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 and in the sidelines, it looks like it says railroad living in company, railroad company boxcars. Next. La Plata City, Missouri in 1910. Next. These are all Mexican workers for the most part, except for the first two lines. And it says a street, but there are no street numbers. So the assumption there, with a little research, we could probably find out that this was a boxcar community. Next. The 1930 census, St. Louis, Missouri, Mexican community at North Broadway. Next. Here's a railroad map from 1920 from the St. Louis Public Library. I wish I could increase it, blow it up so you could see the street. North Broadway follows on this map, basically where the railroad yards were. On one end was Union Station, and as you went north, there were other railroads and stockyards and railroad sidings. A lot of the boxcar communities were on sidings in very industrial areas and yards for other railroad equipment. And if you work north, you'll see where this is the area where this community was. Next. And here's the list. So we've always wondered, since I've been working in St. Louis, and working with the museum, where were these people? Well, here's the evidence. These are all people living in North Broadway. And to be that concentrated and living in sequential, I'm assuming that these were railroad, this was the railroad boxcar community, and these are the numbers of their boxcars where they live, because they're whole, they're families, because you'll see they're all working as railroads, working for the railroad or operated railroad related industries, and you can see the gaps in showing that one's ahead of the household, that they're and they have their families living with them. And this was on North Broadway in St. Louis. So we'll need to do a little more investigation. In fact, one of the goals today is to inspire people to say, wow, these records exist. Who are they? Who are their descendants? Can we go back and pick up their stories? Is there photographic evidence? But that'll be a project for another time, and hopefully I'll be able to participate in it. But I hope that people out of the audience will be interested and take the initiative and follow up with additional research. Next. And this is the second page of the same community. As you can see, the upper half, if you can see they're all born in Mexico. When it says Mexico on these documents, it's typically the mother, the father, but it's consistent in the first few lines up to number 57 that these folks were all Mexican. Next. Another way to find evidence is to look at the draft cards. And I use the keywords Mexican born and Missouri World War I. And here's what I found. Next. This is a draft card for a Pedro Zigaca, and he was born in Nochitlan, Zacatecas, Old Mexico, and he's a laborer for MOPEC, the Missouri and Pacific Railroad. And this is his draft card. Next, and that was from Sedalia. This person is Jesus Villagomez. He is, he is a common laborer for the CB&Q Railroad in Armour Junction, Missouri. Next. This draft card from World War I is for an Andres Torres, and he works for the Missouri, Kansas, and Texas Railroad in Joplin. And he was from Guanajuato, Mexico. Next. World War II Missouri-born draft cards, Mexican-born draft cards. Next. Now, the funny thing about the World War II draft cards, there's no dates, but these are World War II draft cards in terms of the signature. But, so this is a draft card for Bonifacio Zavala in St. Louis, 506 Kimball. And he worked for the MKT, Missouri, Kansas, and Texas Railroad. Next. This is a draft card, World War II draft card for Ignacio Zapien, North Kansas Street, Kansas City. And he was born in place of birth, Gomez Palacio, Mexico. And he works for the Missouri Pacific Railroad, Kansas City. Next. And this is the last draft card. And this is for Jose Carmen Ramirez, Kansas City, born in Salamanca. It says here Salamanca. I suspect it's Salamanca, Old Mexico. And he works for the Kansas City Terminal Railway Company. Next. So that was just a bit of evidence that you know, you could go to the census records, you can go to the draft records, and you will find this information. So how do you measure Mexican and Mexican-American contributions to the U.S.? I love that poster. It says, Americanos todos and luchamos por la victoria from World War II. This is, we are all Americans and we all fight together for victory. Americans all, let's fight for victory. So Mexicans were critical to the successful development of U.S. railroads, agriculture, and commerce. In time of war, we served with distinction in the battlefield and at the home front. They contributed, and their descendants could continue to contribute to the commerce, culture, and brain power of the United States. So our immigrants, people are split on the value of immigrants, but I believe most of us, I hope most of us, because we are a nation of immigrant, understand the value, the struggle, the values, and the contributions of our immigrant communities. So how, in one critical way, and it's not unique to Mexicans or the Mexican American community, but we fought in defense of our country from the Revolutionary War to the present. There's actually an organization called the Sons of the American Revolution. And that's a history that will be told another time because we're almost out of time now. In World War II, because Mexicans were considered white, there's additional research to find out how many served. But in World War II, 500,000 Latinos served in the armed forces of the United States, including 350,000 soldiers that were either Mexican or of Mexican descent. Next. The United States Medal of Honor, Valor, Honor, and Country. Latinos have served in America's wars, as I mentioned, from the American Revolution to the present day conflicts. During the Civil War, the Congress instituted the Medal of Honor. And since that war, 61 medals of honor have been awarded to Latinos by Congress of the United States of America. the Congress recognizes that by identifiable ethnic group, Hispanics rank first for receiving this medal, a military award given for valor in the field of battle, often given posthumously. So in World War II, let me rephrase this. The list of the Mexican-born Medal of Honor recipients, five of the recipients of the Medal of Honor were born in Mexico. One of them could be considered illegal. And so this is a list, Macario Garcia, US Army, born in Villa de Castano, Mexico, Pedro Cano, La Morita, Mexico, Alfred Rascon, Chihuahua, Mexico, Jesus Duran, Juarez, Mexico, Jose Jimenez, Mexico City, Mexico. Next. In closing, with gratitude to my family. Next. As I mentioned, I'm a first generation Mexican. I was born in Mexico. My anchor family, as we were talking earlier about the chain migration, are the people on the left-hand side. And this is my uncle on the top left, my uncle Manuel Perez. This is the Perez Valadez family because his wife is a Valadez. My uncle Manuel, the patriarch, his son Benny on his right, on the middle, my tia, in our culture, in the Mexican culture, and I think of the Hispanic culture in general, but first cousins of your parents are considered tías and tíos. They're our uncles, and that's a form of respect. And so I refer to these are my tíos. Their sons and daughters are my cousins. We call ourselves cousins. But this generation were my uncles. So in the bottom, the middle row, my tía Eulalia. In the middle row is El Padre Valadez, who escaped the Cristero Wars and the turmoil in Mexico and was the chaplain, the priest for the community that you see on the right. This was in Eola, in West Eola in Aurora, Illinois. And on the right, the matriarch, oh, she was a handful. She worked for the CB&Q. Most of the older folks worked for the CB&Q, my tío Manuel, Benny, and tío Lalia. She was a handful, and she was a driver. And she and her husband, my tío Manuel, are the reason that my family came to the United States. Brought my father first, and in 1955-56 brought me, my mom Margarita, to Aurora, Illinois. And so I'm eternally grateful for what they did for us. On the bottom row is my tío Wally, who was quite a character. He was a veteran, fought in the war in the Pacific in World War II. In the middle is my Uncle Pete. Uncle Pete Perez was a very, very special person. He had a lot to do with how I grew up. He is in the history books as being one of the first Hispanic football players in the NFL and one of the first Hispanics to play football for the University of Illinois. And this was during World War II. And he went on to be the first undersheriff of Kane County of Illinois of Mexican descent. His son became the first, my cousin Pat became the first sheriff in Kane County in Illinois of Hispanic descent. And my Uncle Danny is the last child on the bottom row on the right. And of course, this is the chapel at the boxcar community that I showed earlier in an earlier slide. the Mexican community in West Eola, Aurora, Illinois. And that, if you look real close in the middle, it's my great uncle, Father Perez. Next. And of course, a great debt that I owe and grateful to my mother, Margarita, and her husband, my dad, Salvador Valadez Rangel, who is pictured here on the left picture as a bracero for the Southern Pacific in California. And on the left, he's the second one from the right with his hands on his hips, and that kind of explains the person that he was. And I say that with a smile on my face. And on the right-hand picture, he's the one with his foot up on the way car with a pith helmet. But from these families, I learned the values of being a Mexican, of being an American. We were taught the customs, we were taught the music, the relationships, the padrinos, the godfathers, the role of the godfathers, the comadres and the compadres, the food, the culture, the history. My dad would tell us, you know, we are very proud to be in the United States. It's been good to us. We will work hard and you will receive your education and do better. He says, we love this country, but you will never forget your history and culture. And because it's so important, because if you don't know who you are, how do you know where you're going to go? So that's my story. That's just, I hope that I presented you with information that will encourage you to continue research and ask questions. I'm open to you reaching out to me, and I thank you, and I'm sorry we didn't give you enough time to ask questions. And that's the end of my presentation.
Well, I want to thanks, Sal, again. I don't know if we have any questions. I've not seen any posted yet, but I did post Sal's email and phone number in the chat. If you have any questions after our presentation ends, feel free to reach out to him.
Well, I'm sorry for the length. I try to fly through those slides, but.
No worries. Let me just share my screen one last time before we leave today. So I do want to thank Sal Valadez again for joining us this morning. We have our regularly scheduled STL History Live programs on Tuesday at 11 a.m. and Thursdays at 6:30 p.m., as well as Soldiers Memorial Chow and Chats on select Wednesdays at noon. You can see a couple of the upcoming programs on this slide, and you can find links for all our upcoming programs at mohistory.org, or on the Missouri History Museum Facebook page. So please be sure to check out that lineup. And please don't forget to fill out the survey and let us know what you thought about our program today. Thanks again to you for joining us, and we'll see you next time. Have a good day, everyone.
Bye-bye. Thank you very much.